Speaking to reporters on Air Force One in a conversation the White House will not allow us to play the audio from, President Trump says he, quote, really believes Putin means it when he says he didn't meddle, saying, quote, he says, I didn't do that. I think he is very insulted by it. If you want to know the truth, don't forget. All he said is he never did that. He didn't do that. I think he's very insulted by it, which is not a good thing for our country, unquote. And then he went on to suggest the assessment of the U.S. intelligence community was politically motivated. He said, quote, I mean, give me a break. They're political hacks. So you look at it. I mean, you have Brennan, you have Clapper, and you have Comey. Comey's proven now to be a liar, and he's proven to be a leaker. So you look at that, and you have President Putin very strongly, vehemently says he had nothing to do with that. Here to respond directly to the president's comments are two of the former intelligence chiefs the president called out, former CIA Director John Brennan and former Director of National Intelligence General James Clapper. I'll just start. What is your response, Mr. Brennan, to what President Trump said about Vladimir Putin and U.S. intelligence agencies?
Well, I think Mr. Trump knows that the intelligence agencies, specifically CIA, NSA, and FBI, the ones that really have responsibility for counterintelligence and looking at what Russia does, it's very clear that the Russians interfered in the election, and it's still puzzling as to why Mr. Trump does not acknowledge that and embrace it and also push back hard against Mr. Putin. The Russian threat to our democracy and our democratic foundations is real, and I think his continuing to not say very clearly and strongly that this is a national security problem and to say to Mr. Putin, we know you did it, you'd have to stop it because there are going to be consequences if you don't.
And he, once again, he said what he said and originally and giving the impression to a lot of people that he sided with Putin and he started attacking the U.S. intelligence agencies, you two in particular. And then when given an opportunity to clarify, to say, what do you believe, he didn't really clarify. He said, he didn't say, I believe Russia interfered in the 2016 election and I think they need to stop and I take it very seriously. He said, Putin believes what he believes and, you know, I side with our intelligence agencies. But it was vague. Why do you think he does that?
I don't know why the ambiguity about this, because the threat posed by Russia, as John just said, is manifest and obvious and has been for a long time. Putin is committed to undermining our system, our democracy, and our whole process. And to try to paint it in any other way is, I think, astounding and, in fact, poses a peril to this country.
What threat, what peril does it pose to the country?
Well, for one, as we've seen in the evidence that's come out since the publication of our intelligence community assessment on the 6th of January, it further reinforces the depth and magnitude and scope and the aggressiveness of the Russian interference, to include their very astute use of social media. Apart from that, something we don't think about too much is the fact that the Russians are embarked on a very aggressive modernization of their strategic nuclear forces, to include a very capable and scary counter space program. They only have one adversary in mind when they do this. And oh, by the way, the Russians are in abject violation of the INF Treaty, the Intermediate Nuclear Forces Treaty. So the Russians do not harbor good intentions toward the United States. And there shouldn't be any illusions or any ambiguity about that. And our president fosters that ambiguity.
The president also called both of you and FBI Director Comey political hacks. All three of you worked in senior levels in the Obama administration, although you also worked during the Bush administration. How do you respond to the charge?
Well, first of all, he was referring to us as political hacks because he was trying to delegitimize the intelligence community assessment that was done. Jim Clapper, Jim Comey, and John Brennan did not write that assessment. It was written by the professional intelligence officers and law enforcement officers of this great country. Secondly, I feel very honored to be associated with Jim Clapper and Jim Comey in the same category. And considering the source of the criticism, I consider that criticism a badge of honor. And third, I found it particularly reprehensible that on Veterans Day, that Donald Trump would attack and impugn the integrity and the character of Jim Clapper, who served in uniform for 35 years, who responded to the call of his country to go to Vietnam, flew in over 70 combat support missions over Vietnam, and like Senator McCain, really did put his life at risk because of this country's national security. And to impugn the character of somebody like Jim Clapper on Veterans Day, who has dedicated so much of his life to this country, I just find that outrageous, and it's something that I think that the that Mr. Trump should be ashamed of, but it doesn't seem as though anything he does, he feels any shame whatsoever.
What is the effect of these attacks, not on you two or Jim Comey, but on other people in the FBI, in the CIA, in the NSA, people who are still there, who worked under you and are still there working to try to make the country safer?
First, I have to reciprocate what an honor it has been to serve with the likes of John Brennan and Jim Comey, who are dedicated public servants and have served this country long and well and with great integrity. I think it can't have a positive cannot have a positive impact on the morale or of the workforce, the Intelligence Committee. But I do believe, in my heart, that the men and women of the Intelligence Community will continue to convey truth to power, even if the power ignores the truth.
At one point, President Trump said he thinks Vladimir Putin is insulted by the suggestion and the conclusion by the intelligence agencies that Russia interfered in the U.S. election. What do you make of that? His bringing up that Putin feels insulted.
Well, I think Mr. Putin is very clever in terms of playing to Mr. Trump's interest in being flattered. And also, I think Mr. Trump is, for whatever reason, either intimidated by Mr. Putin, afraid of what he could do or what might come out as a result of these investigations. So it's very worrisome, and I think it sends a worrisome, very disturbing signal to our allies and partners who are concerned about Russian interference in their democratic processes as well. So it's either naivete, ignorance, or fear in terms of what Mr. Trump is doing vis-a-vis the Russians.
President Trump took to Twitter yesterday to try to justify his position, his posture towards Russia. He said, quote, "When will all the haters and fools out there realize that having a good relationship with Russia is a good thing, not a bad thing? They're always playing politics." There was misspelled. "They're always playing politics, bad for our country. I want to solve North Korea, Syria, Ukraine, terrorism, and Russia. You can greatly help." So that's his argument. Russia can be a help on these issues, and that the posture of being belligerent towards Russia won't assist in that matter.
Well, I suppose they could be, but I think it's naive to assume they will be. Again, the likelihood that the Russians are going to pursue like interests with us is slim and none. And I think it's very naive and again, in fact, perilous to this country to make an assumption that Russia is going to behave with the best interests of the world or certainly the United States in mind. They're not.
So, Mr. Brennan, Director Brennan, you said a couple minutes ago, you talked about the reasons why President Trump might be susceptible to what Putin tells him. And you talked about flattery. You also talked about fear. I can't ignore the fact that all of this comes at a time when there's a lot of speculation about whether or not the Russians have damaging information about President Trump. This comes, of course, within the context of the fact that President Trump has been willing to criticize everyone from the cast of Hamilton to Meryl Streep, but has yet to say one disparaging word about Vladimir Putin. Do you think this idea that maybe the Russians have something about on him, have compromising material, is relevant here?
Well, I don't know if Mr. Trump is considering that. I just know that he has been very determined to try to delegitimize any effort to come up with the truth in terms of this investigation. His attacks on the intelligence community, on the assessment, the attacks on the media. This is an effort to, again, try to undermine those quarters that could pose a serious threat to him. Also, I think it shows the insecurity that he still feels about the election and how Russian interference may have contributed, in fact, to that election. So I think there's a combination of factors that are motivating the president at this time.
Do you know of any compromising material that the Russians might have on him?
I have shared everything I know with the intelligence committees.
That's not a no or a yes, because we're not privy to the information that you gave to the intelligence committees.
That's true.
Okay. Let me ask you a question about how in 2016 you were all watching and monitoring and assessing what was going on with the Russian interference. In retrospect, was it a mistake of President Obama not to make a bigger public deal of this at the time?
Well, this is in the coulda, woulda, shoulda department. Bearing in mind, there really wasn't much of a template or rule book for how to handle a situation like this. I think the arguments, the concern that the administration had was, if we did make a big public deal of this, would we first be amplifying what the Russians were doing? And I think, frankly, the president was probably sensitive to the accusation that he was putting his hand on the scale and trying to affect the outcome of the election if he spoke up about it. Now, we did. We put out a statement. At the time, then Secretary of Homeland Security Jay Johnson and I put out a statement on the 7th of October, which was a pretty forthright statement about what the Russians were doing, and it was issued before the election. Unfortunately, it got emasculated and overcome by the excess Hollywood tapes, and so it sort of got lost in all that. I think what was done was appropriate. I guess you could go back and say, well, we should have been more aggressive or done something earlier. I don't know, but there were good reasons why there was caution and discretion here.
Director Brennan, so General Clapper just said there wasn't a template, but Russians have been attempting to interfere in elections before. 2016 was not the first time. It was the most successful time ever, probably, in Russian history. But it wasn't the first time. Why were the intelligence agencies, and not just the intelligence agencies, law enforcement, communications, every part of the government, why was it not better prepared?
Well, I think we were prepared. Question of during campaign season, you want to be able to understand everything that the Russians might do. So we had a responsibility to make sure the president and the Congress were informed, public statements that were made about Russian attempts to interfere. At the same time, we wanted to be able to know what they were doing so that we might be able to thwart anything more extensive that they might have done. And I do think that the pushback, both publicly and privately against the Russians, gave the Russians some pause because it was made very clear to them that we were onto their game and that it was going to have very serious consequences. So I think the intelligence community, law enforcement, have their counterintelligence antenna up all the time. And I think we did a pretty admirable job.
Since you two left the office in January 2017, we've learned more about attempts by the Russians to reach out to the Trump campaign. We've learned about Donald Trump Jr. eagerly accepting a meeting to get dirt on Hillary Clinton from somebody he was told was a Russian lawyer. We've learned with the Comey plea agreement with George Papadopoulos, former foreign advisor for the Trump campaign. We've learned that he was told by a professor with ties to the Kremlin in April 2016, long before I knew anything about the hacking or the public knew anything about the hacking, that the Russians were claiming that they had damaging information. Now, you said in January 2017, this year, that you knew of no collusion. Did you know of those two events?
No, I did not. And the statement I made at the time was true. I had no direct evidence of collusion. Now, we had lots of concerns because we were aware of multiple meetings that were going on, while at least my part was not aware directly of the content of these meetings. But we were certainly concerned, and the metaphor I've used before is I think our dashboard warning lights were clearly on about what was going on. But to say specifically that we had evidence of smoking gun evidence of collusion, no. But, of course, a lot more has come out. Raises, I think, circumstantial questions, if nothing else.
What message do you think President Trump is sending to Vladimir Putin right now in terms of Russia's continued attempts to interfere in elections in Europe and potentially in the United States again?
Well, I think what he's doing is saying to Vladimir Putin, we need to put this behind us because there's important work to be done. And I agree, we need to be able to find a way to improve relations between Moscow and Washington. But I think what by not confronting the issue directly and not acknowledging to Putin that we know that you're responsible for this, I think he's giving Putin a pass. And I think it demonstrates to Mr. Putin that Donald Trump can be played by foreign leaders who are going to appeal to his ego and to try to play upon his insecurities, which is very, very worrisome from a national security standpoint.
Do you agree that Donald Trump can be played by foreign leaders like Putin? And if so, does that make you concerned about the security of the United States?
I do. I think, he seems very susceptible to rolling out the red carpet and honor guards and all the trappings. and pomp and circumstance that come with the office. And I think that that appeals to him, and I think it plays to his insecurities. And yes, I do think both the Chinese and the Russians think they can play him.
And then lastly, do you know, and maybe you can't answer this question, but do you know, Director Brennan, of any laws broken by the Trump campaign, anybody affiliated with the Trump campaign, when it comes to working with the Russians on election interference?
I'm just a former intelligence officer. I never had the responsibility for determining whether or not criminal actions were taken. But since leaving office on the 20th of January, I think more and more of this iceberg is emerging above the surface of the water. Some of the things that I knew about, but some of the things I didn't know about in terms of some of the social media efforts that Russia employed. So I think what Bob Mueller, who again is another quintessential public servant, is doing is trying to get to the bottom of this. And I think we're going to find out how large this iceberg really is.
All right. And if I could add, I just think it's absolutely critical for the country that there be closure on this and there be some finality to what did happen.
All right, General Clapper and Director Brennan, thank you so much for being here. We really appreciate it. Thank you so much.